So guys, we'll bring on the main act. We'll give a thunderous round of applause, bringing your main act, Rabindra Khannan, guys. Clap, 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 clap. Check, check, check. Thank you. Thank you so much for coming, everybody. Give yourself a huge round of applause. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for coming. I really liked how in the beginning, like, five people were clapping enthusiastically and the others were peer pressured into it. Nice feeling. So before I start, good news and bad news, okay? Good news, the show is getting recorded for an OTT. Bad news, the OTT is YouTube. Yeah, the Amazon people had some problem with me. Apparently, they have no idea who I am. So I say, okay, that is a problem. So thank you so much, guys. Give yourself a huge round of applause again. Thank you so much for coming. I really appreciate it. Anyway, welcome to the show. The show is called None of This Matters. I've been doing this for a while now. And when I first launched the show on Instagram and stuff, people were so supportive, man. All my comedy friends, comics especially, they all shared it, and that made me, you know, I had mixed feelings about that, because the last few years, anytime any comic has posted any good news, I've always gone to that post and reported it. It's like, yes, Instagram, his happiness is offensive to me. So when all my comedy friends shared it, I felt so bad, man. I said, have I been a bad person all these years? But Arvind, they say, in fact, shared it, yeah. Any SA fans here? Yella sholi irukinga. No, he shared it, and one guy saw SA's post and messaged me on Instagram saying, hey bro, I saw SA posted about your show, and it was a beautiful feeling, you know, of community of comics supporting each other. Before I could finish the thought, that guy sent another message saying, do you know when he's doing his new show? Oh, that day, enna enda keta. And that guy had an explanation also. No, bro, SA is very famous. He might not check messages and all. You only have some 1,000 followers, no? That's why. I immediately went to SA's profile and reported all his posts. Fuck him, fuck him, fuck him, fuck him. So anyway, it's so nice, man. It's so nice to, you know, perform in front of live audiences again, you know. I've been doing shows on Zoom, and I really miss talking to audiences after shows, you know. That's something I really missed. A few weeks back, I did a show and this guy came to me and he said, hey bro, good show. I said, hey, thanks, man. And then he looked at me straight into my eyes and said, I'm serious, bro. Why would I think you were being sarcastic? Like, what about my personality makes someone give me a compliment and then reassure me that they're not joking? But it turns out, by the way, that this guy was a huge comedy fan, man. You know, stand-up comedy fan, not my fan, comedy fan. So he asked me saying, like, bro, can you share some tips about how you come up with material, what do comics do and all that? And that's so nice, no? So I told him, so basically, bro, what I do is I sit around all day and I think of things. And if something strikes me, I write it in a notebook. And then evening, I say it in shows. As I was saying it, I could see the respect on his face go down. I could see the respect on my own face also go down. Is this what I do for a living? What is wrong with me? But this is what I do for a living, by the way. I'm currently a professional full-time comedian. Yeah. Thank you for that round of silence. One guy was cheering, everybody was like, Nia, you're not even famous. No, really, man. I had a day job and then evenings I used to do comedy. But in January of 2020, I quit my day job to pursue comedy professionally. Yeah. 2020 was going to be my year, I told myself. Yeah. What the year did to me is a bigger joke than any joke I'll ever write. Disaster, man. But if you were an artist in 2020, life was really strange, okay? Life was really strange because I just had so much free time that it was embarrassing, man. I don't think an adult human being is supposed to have the volume of free time that I had last year. Like, my friends used to call me saying, Macha, what are you up to, da? I'll be like, bro, I'm working on some projects, actually. There were no projects. I was just ashamed. I didn't know what to do with myself all of last year, man. I read online that, you know, like, take cold showers in the morning, you'll feel energetic, you know. I tried it. I took a cold shower. I felt energetic. I didn't know what to do with that energy. I was like, oh, I didn't think this through. Like, my dog and I had the same life last year. Exact same life. No, actually, you know, there were a few key differences. You know, like, he'll stare at the road, I'll stare at my phone. He'll poop outside. Thankfully, I pooped inside. He got horny and he was humping the sofa leg. Actually, that was me. Sorry, that was me. It was, yeah. It was a long, lonely lockdown. You feel me, bro? Yeah. But no, really, man. It's been, you know, I'll tell you why or how I quit my job, because I had to quit, okay? Because sometime in early Jan last year, I was on my way to office and I was going like at 60 full speed. My full speed is 60, by the way. Yeah. And I was rushing to office because I was late. And then there was this auto guy coming towards me, okay? And you know, in that nanosecond, you know you're going to hit somebody, no? And then you know how before accidents, the two parties involved in accidents do this pre-accident dance move, no? They'll be like, hey, left, right, come on, let's go, you know? So it's a deadly choreography, man. So we both did that dance and then we clashed, okay, full speed. And you know how when like an accident happens, your body pumps in adrenaline and you come to the moment and all that? My body gave up on the spot. I immediately passed out, man. My body didn't have adrenaline and all. I went straight into kai pulla thoongidumor. It's a miracle I survived the pandemic so far. You know, but I passed out on the spot, man. And then I woke up, I was like, na yari, enga iruken, and all that. And that guy, one guy was like, bro, don't do overacting, it's been 2 minutes only. So, and then the first thing I noticed when I opened my eyes was that the auto anna was shouting at me, okay? Which was strange because he'd basically been shouting at an unconscious body. Because it's not like I opened my eyes, he saw me and started shouting. When I opened my eyes, he was halfway through an insult. He was like, oh, the sangre, I was like, bro, please wait, let me freshen up and come. You know? But, you know, I saw myself, there were like bruises on my arms and there was like blood oozing out of my leg and everything and my bike was scattered somewhere. And, you know, and the first thing that occurred to my brain was, habara inik office leave. That was my number one thought, man. And that really depressed me, you know. It's like if I'm in an accident and my number one thought is office povana, then there is something wrong, no? I was lying down looking at the clear blue Chennai sky and I knew that I was having a profound moment, you know. And in the clear blue Chennai sky, the auto on his face came inside. And he said the most beautiful sentence I've heard. He said, De Savagaraki, Tanni Vedama. He said, De Savagaraki, Tanni Vedama. Anna, ninga nallavara, kettavara, I'm not sure. But, you know, I rushed to the hospital and I was just thinking about this office thing, man, because it really disturbed me. I was rushed to the hospital and the doctor looked at me and he said, you know what, your injuries are not that bad, but you need 1 week of bed rest, you know. And then I looked at the doctor and I said, doctor, if you take this knife and stab me, I can take 1 month leave from office. Please help me out here. But, you know, that was the moment I decided, you know, like I'm going to quit my job. I'm going to pursue my truth. I'm going to pursue my passion. I think the problem was that a few months before that, 5,000 kilometers away, somebody in China ate a bat. And my life has been downhill ever since. I know it's not that guy's fault or China's fault. I know it's racist. This is my new thing, by the way. I get offended at my own jokes before the audience can get offended. Stay one step ahead. But so I've been living the professional comedian's life, man, last 15 months. And it's a different kind of pressure, you know, because a few years back, comedy was a hobby. So when I said a joke and the joke didn't work, I'll think to myself, let me rewrite the joke, you know, I'll work on it. Now, if I say a joke and the joke doesn't work, I'm thinking in my head, how will I afford food next month? 200 plus 300 patta de engine. But it's okay, I don't regret the decision, you know, because my goal in comedy, my comedy career, is to be known as an underrated comedian. That's all I want to achieve. That's my benchmark. And that's my favorite compliment, man. Even when somebody says I'm good, I don't feel good. But if somebody says I'm underrated, I feel amazing. Because if you think about it, it's the best compliment you can receive, you know. Because when they say you're underrated, they mean two things. They mean that they think you're good. But more importantly, they mean that they think other people should think you're good. Ultimate compliment, man. Yeah. I've decided I want to be underrated in everything. I asked my girlfriend recently, baby, do you think I'm an underrated boyfriend? She said, what do you mean? Do you like me? She said, yeah. Do you think other girls should like me? She said, oh, moonji ko onne jaasti. But anyway, I'm 32 years old. People above 30, give me a shout. Nice, nice. Did you hear the sound of shattered dreams? 32 feels old mentally, man, you know, like not physically, because physically, you know, I've always been weak, so. You know how you climb two flights of stairs now and you're, you know, panting? I was like that when I was 8 years old. I asked my mom once, Mommy, did you smoke when you were pregnant with me? Didn't go down well. So, but I do feel old mentally, man. I'll tell you like an example. A couple of months back, I was masturbating, okay? Yeah. Hey, don't go cold on me. We're going through a pandemic together. We should be able to talk about masturbation, okay? I mean, I'll talk, you listen. But I was masturbating and halfway through the act, I thought about the Airtel broadband bill that I have to pay next day. Do you know how old you have to be? If you have porn in front of you and you are reminded of life responsibility, it was depressing, man. Worst thing was that thought didn't even stop me. I was half thinking about the bill and continuing. 1,000 plus GST plus Modi ji, Achhe Din. Achhe Din never came, but I came that time. So. But yeah, I do feel old, man. You know, I'm totally fine with this whole uncle thing, you know. Like, I don't know why guys make such a big deal out of it. Like, one close friend of mine, he came to me and he said, Macha, my life is over. He said, why, da, what happened? My neighbor girl called me uncle. He said, I know that girl. She's 9 years old. If she calls you anything other than uncle, police will get involved. I've always embraced this uncle thing, man. Whenever a kid calls me uncle, I'll be like, yes, Kanna, tell me, ma. Life is pointless, okay? Sooner you know, better it is. I do have a weird age distortion, though, because I'm okay with being called uncle. My problem is that I constantly call people much younger than me, Anna. It's wired into my head, man. Like, I went to my area department store, and I got everything. He gave me the bag, and I said, thanks, Anna. And that kid was like fucking 16 or something, okay? He looked at me like, who is this psychopath? Why is he calling me Anna? Like, that guy's, that department store guy, his name is Anand, okay? And ever since I called him Anna, he's just judged me, man. Like, my entire lockdown went into trying to convince Anand that I'm a good guy. That's all I did, all lockdown. Like, you know, he used to come with this water can delivery. And I'll always open the door and be like, hey, Anand, come on inside, bro. And he'll be like, bro, stop creeping me out. And he'll keep the water can in the gate and leave me. It's like, bro, my body is not meant to lift this thing. Please help me. But, you know, I got a break from Anand recently because I went to the store. I got everything. And the bill was 91 rupees. I gave him a 100 rupee note. And he said, Urba Irka. Okay. And if you guys don't know, this Urba Irka is a Tamil Nadu departmental store code for friendship. Because what happens is that you'll try to reach for that 1 rupee. Before that, that guy will be like, actually, you know what? It's okay, pa. What is 1 rupee between us? We are not like owner customer. We are more like family, you know. And as soon as he says that, you'll feel one warmth radiate inside of you. Be like, yeah, I do like you more than my actual family, you know. I look forward to those moments, man. So when Anand said, Ohuba Irka, I knew what this meant. I said, bro, I got you, bro, I understood. And he took my wallet, except that it's okay, pa, never came. I was emptying my contents of my wallet, he didn't budge. I was emptying my pockets, I was removing my shirt and all, he didn't budge, man. And then somebody behind me in the counter tapped my shoulder and gave me Urba in my hand. But I made one mistake with Anand and he's just not forgiven me, you know. But I feel like we all do that. We are not, we don't forgive people for mistakes, you know. I think cricket is a good example of that, you know. Like in cricket, no, if somebody drops a single catch, the next 5 minutes, three commentators and seven different camera angles will humiliate that guy till he wants to retire from sports forever. There'll be one moment of failure, okay? He would have dropped it. They will make an Instagram boomerang out of it and play it on the big screen in front of him 25 times. And the commentators will also bully him, man. They'll be like, you know, in a professional level, you're like, hey, Manjareka, shut up, da. You would have dropped this for sure. And the player will be so guilty that he'll have to do these fake regret things. So he'll kick the ground. He'll curse at the gods and all. Why do we do that, man? Even the umpires, you know, even the umpires in cricket, they have cool signs for everything, you know. Like if somebody gets out, they'll be this. Somebody hits a four, they'll do this. But if it goes for a referral and the umpire has to admit that he made a mistake, they will make that man do the most humiliating pose a human being can do. He'll be like, "Rumba saagine, theriyama tappa solitan." And the players also be like, "Oh, thoppu karana podu, patta thaga podu." But, you know, I just thought I'll be a classier person by this time. You know, that's what really bugs me, man. You know, by this time, I thought I'd be a classier guy. I'm not that, you know, that really makes me feel bad. Like, even now, if I go to a restaurant and I have the menu and the waiter is standing here, if I have to order something now, I won't just tell him what I want. I look at him and I'll point at the thing I want. Like a caveman. Anna, this I want. You give, I put here. I think a good measure of somebody's classiness is how they order veg puff. Because I've realized it's the most disarming food that you can order, man. Like, you know, Satyam Cinemas, hashtag nostalgia. I used to go there and I'll be at the counter. I'll be like, excuse me, I'll have a popcorn. I'll have a Coke to go with it, maybe, yeah. And one veg puff, Sana. I don't know why veg puff is singular. We always say puffs and he understands we mean one. And I don't know why, as soon as I start saying it, one finger automatically goes up, man. I think puff reminds us of our childhood, no? That miss one bathroom, miss memory gets triggered. Same feeling we do. Anna, veg puffs? No, egg puffs. So anyway, I have major OCD issues, man. And I know OCD is a serious thing, you know. Because some people sometimes take it a little too light, you know. Like some guys will be like, bro, I have bad OCD, bro. I have to brush my teeth every day. That's not OCD, machan. That's basic dental hygiene. Like anybody here has that OCD where they need to clean stuff obsessively? No? Wow. Oh, you don't know? Yeah. What's your name? Sorry. This much regret is not good, Aishwarya. So, listen, the thing is, I hate people like Aishwarya, okay? See, because she has OCD, but it's at least helpful OCD, you know? She has to clean stuff, it's manageable. I have this weird OCD, man, and I've had it since I was a kid, okay? I have this weird thing where whatever I feel on one side of my body, you know, I have to feel the same thing on the other side of my body as well. Yeah. You know how when people walk on tiles, they have to walk evenly? I have like a demonic internal version of it. It's like my brain has one drunken friend that makes me do stupid things, you know? Like if I unlock my phone with my right thumb, I'll keep it down and then unlock it with my left thumb. Because my brain is like, make it even, make it even. Like I've gone to the barber and come out bald. Because he'll cut this side, I'll unlock this side. Another thing. It's horrible, man. But to be honest, the real victim of my OCD is actually my girlfriend. Because I am the single most high maintenance person to make out with ever. Like, I remember the first time we kissed, you know. I was holding her. She had her hand on me and, you know, and she was like whispered saying like, baby, what do you want to do next? And I went in close to her and said, baby, can you gently place your right hand also on my right cheek, please. She was doing this. It was like she was petting a dog. She said, goodbye. Goodbye, me. And she was looking down. You stay down. Bad boy. Oh, what? Dick joke doesn't work, eh? Chumma pretending, everybody. But this OCD also gets me into trouble, man. I'll tell you, like a few months back, it was late at night and I was alone with my dog, Mowgli, you know. And we were both chilling. I was lying down. He was next to me. And it was one of those late night moments, you know, when like if the day was over, you're just chilling out, you're relaxed. And unfortunately, I started thinking about life. And then I started thinking about my stand-up career. And then I looked at the AC in front of me. And I thought to myself, you know what? My stand-up career is not at a place where I can afford 21 degrees high-speed AC. At best, my career is at 29 degrees low-speed AC. So I changed the AC setting, except it got hot. So I removed my T-shirt. Don't imagine that. Only because it's not a pleasant sight to imagine. There's nothing happening here. So I removed my shirt. I was lying down, except my dog, Mowgli, he sensed some change in the room. Okay, so he came close to me. And then in one swift movement, he came closer, licked my right nipple, and ran away. My OCD went batshit crazy, man. I was like, somebody needs to lick my left nipple right now, or I'm going to lose my shit. This was happening at 1 a.m. I didn't know what to do. I licked my hand and rubbed it here. It didn't work. It was like I was trying to summon a genie or something. I mean, nothing came out. Thank God nothing came out. It was horrible, okay? I didn't know what to do, man. And my brain didn't let it go, you know? So between 1 o'clock and 1:30 in the night, I was chasing my dog around the room, trying to get him to lick my left nipple also. It looked like I was trying to breastfeed him. It's like, Mowgli, 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 Mowgli. All you animal lovers, don't judge me. Because my dog liked it. He thought it's this new fun game that we're playing. He's like, no, bro, I'm going through hell here. Please help me out. It was so bad, man. At 1:30, I tried doing some extreme neck rotation to see if my tongue can reach my chest area. Hey. All guys here, don't pretend, okay? At some point in your adolescence, you've tried to lick your own body part. And you know exactly what body part I'm talking about. My dog and I look the same, by the way. Both of us were trying to lick us. It got really bad, man. I didn't know what to do. I couldn't let it go. So at 2 o'clock, I called my girlfriend. I said, baby, there's an emergency. She's like, oh my God, what happened? Are you all right? Listen, everything is okay. But somebody needs to lick my left nipple. And she lost it, okay? She's like, you idiot, what is wrong with you? It's 2 o'clock in the morning. And then she realized, wait, it's 2 o'clock in the morning. Who licked your right nipple? Are you cheating on me? I was like, no, it was Mowgli. She was like, that's worse, you idiot. And she kept the phone. And, but at 2:30, I found the solution. And I'm not proud of this. Actually, you know what? I'm not proud of any part of this story. Just so we are clear. But at 2:30, what I did is I went and took a dog treat and rubbed it all over my left nipple area. Don't be a hater, because it worked. As soon as I did it, my dog stood up. I was like, yes, you know, my superior human intelligence has triumphed over his animal instincts. And then I rubbed it and I was standing like, you know, Shah Rukh Khan does in these Hindi padams, no? I want you to think of my nipple whenever you see Shah Rukh Khan. But I was standing there waiting for Mowgli and he came running towards me. It worked. And except he came towards me, jumped up and gave me a bite on this side and ran away. I said, oh shit, now I need a bite on this side and a lick on this side. We are done with the nipple jokes, ladies and gentlemen. So, we've come to the last segment of the show. And do you guys mind if we, like, sort of end the show a little more serious? Is that okay?
Yeah?
I love how nobody gives a fuck, you know. Everybody's like, we've come, you do whatever you want, we don't care. So I'll tell you what. When I was in my 20s, my parents passed away, man. And I told you it'll get serious, but you know, not in some freak accident or something. My dad, when I was like 21 or so, and he had a sudden cardiac thing, and unfortunately, a few years back, my mother also passed because of some health complications. Because, you know, as a comic, obviously when your parents pass, you know, you feel bad because you lose out on so much content. But, you know, I don't have jokes about it. I mean, I have a few, but but I have stories to tell, you know. This has been such a huge part of my life, you know, like that I thought when I do a show, I should sort of address it or talk about it at least, because I think we don't talk enough about death, right? We don't know how to process it. We don't know how to think about it. Like, even, you know, right now, everybody was laughing, having a good time. Now everybody's like, what the fuck is this going on? You know, because we don't talk about it, man. And every show I've realized that, unfortunately, there's, you know, somebody here, I'm sorry, but you would have loved, lost someone close to you. And we don't have the infrastructure for grief, you know. We don't know how to process that. And I'll tell you what, like, my parents were this typical, you know, arranged marriage couple, you know. Like, even they had this cute meeting story and all that where my dad went to my mother's place for this whole ponnu pathifying thing, you know. Like, where he went there and my mother offered him coffee. And my dad took it from his left hand, okay. Which, if you're not aware, is the 1970s equivalent of a Tinder swipe left. Because my mother saw him take from left hand and thought, you know, it's a bad sign. He doesn't like me and all that, right? Except what happened is that my dad found her after the ponnu pathifying thing and told her that he'd actually lost a bit of his index finger in an accident. So he didn't want my mom to see that and be grossed out. That's why he took it from his left hand and he actually likes her and all that, you know. Like sweet stories like this. And they were also, my parents were, you know, typical Indian parents, I think. Like my dad was, you know, the alpha male dad, you know, like always strict kind of thing, you know. I remember whenever I went into a new class in school, no, he'll always meet me and he'll be like, Rabi, inime serious time in life, okay? I'll be like, Naina, I'm going to second standard. I think this is a little too much, bro. You know? So I always grew up as like my mother's favorite and everything. And what happened is that when I was 21 is when my dad had a sudden cardiac arrest and passed away. And, you know, and that was like really strange, man, because I was just stepping into adult life and this sort of like blew me out, you know. But the weird thing is that when like a father figure passes in our society, we don't grieve about it that much because people do this immediate thing of, you know, like, you are now the man of the family kind of thing, right? Like, me and my brothers, everybody was like, you're now the man of the family. Be responsible. Get a job. Go chase money, happiness, success, whatever it is. You are the man of the family. Be responsible and everything. And that sort of became the main theme after my father's death. And, you know, me and my brothers, we moved on with life. You know, we got to some sort of normalcy. And unfortunately, like I said, my mother had some health complications a few years back and she passed. And, you know, if a parent passes away, and you feel sad, just wait till the other parent you like significantly better passes away. Because when my mom died, I was shattered, man. I was like, I didn't know how to process it, you know. I was like, wait, did I not like my father that much? This was we'll get into that later. But, you know, when my mom passed, I didn't know what to do, right? And even the relatives or people around me, they didn't have this, you're the man of the house defense, right? And because you know, all my relatives used to come to me and they say, you know, your mother is still around you. Your mother is still around you. You know how people say that, right? And that really pissed me off, man. Every time somebody said that, I got angry, right? Because I don't believe in afterlife and all that. I believe that when somebody is dead, they're dead, right? So whenever they said that, it really pissed me off. And on top of that, the other thing that was bothering me was that I had sort of developed this romantic notion of death, you know? And I think some of us have it that when somebody dies, close to you dies, you think that, you know, one day the sun will shine on your face and everything will change, or you'll be standing in the beach and the waves will come over and you'll be a different person kind of thing. And I just noticed that that wasn't true, man. Because my dad passed, I was the same guy. And my mother passed, I was the same guy. And that made me feel really shitty because I'm like, am I not a good person? Am I not a good son? Why is my life not changing drastically, right? And this is how things were. And I'll tell you, like a couple of weeks after my mother passed, my brother and I went out to get some vegetables and stuff. Actually, we went out to get cigarettes, you know. I can say it now. But we went to get cigarettes, we smoked, and we came back and we opened the house, and the house was in complete chaos, you know. Like, there was, like, thuni old clothes lying about, this leftover stinking food. There was this flowers from, like, 2 weeks back or something. And it looked, like, horrible, man. And we were both at the gate. I looked at my brother and I said, wow, who died here? As soon as I said that, we both started laughing, okay? Because this is exactly the kind of sick, dark joke that would have cracked my mother up, right? And we were both laughing for the first time in 2 weeks. And at that moment, I could finally feel what all my relatives were saying when she's still around you, you know? Because I could sense my mother around me when I was laughing out loud, man. And that really, that moment really shook me because, you know, I was sort of chasing these big highs after death, right? I thought life will change, everything will happen. But if I remembered my mother in the most silliest joke, in the most random time, then maybe the biggest lesson there is that maybe life is not about the big things, right? Maybe life is about the small things, man. Because I've been holding on to that moment because it keeps reminding me of this, like, you know, if I'm walking down the road and a kid sees me and my dog walking together and he's fascinated by that, right? And that moment is beautiful. Maybe that's the most important thing, right? I'd forgotten that in my rat race in my 20s. I'd completely lost track of that. And, I'm still holding on to that one moment I had because, you know, it reminds me that maybe the biggest lesson is in life is to just stop and smell the flowers now and then, man. Maybe the most important thing in life is to just watch a stupid movie with a date, right? Maybe the most important thing in life is to just eat your favorite food and chill out. Maybe the most important thing in life is for your dog to lick your left nipple. Thank you so much for coming, everybody. That's been the show. Thank you. Thank you.